sitting near Piccadilly. Don't really know how I got here. I got some bitches on my phone, new names and numbers that I don't know. Address to places like Abbey Road. Day turns to night, night turns to whatever we want. We're young enough to say,
everyone. My name is Sam Schwartz, and I'm Member Engagement and Marketing Manager for the AABC Commissioning Group. Thank you for joining us here for our ongoing Essential Commissioning webinar series. Every month, we've been hosting a new presentation covering a different facet of the commissioning process, and this particular session is sponsored by CxA+BE, so thank you to them. I'm going to go over a few notes before we get started today. Presenters will be answering any questions at the end of the presentation, so we encourage you to submit them at any time using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. If you happen to be experiencing any technical issues during the webinar, please use the chat function to inform the panelists, and we will do our best to assist you. This presentation is being recorded and will be available for viewing in 1 week. Everyone will receive an automated email after the webinar with a proof of attendance. And then finally, if you are a certified CxA, EMP, TBE, or TBE, this is in regards to EMA, ACG, and AABC members, staff will be uploading your certificates of attendance for you within 1 week to your respective member portals. Today's webinar is Considerations for Energy Efficiency, Retrofit versus New Construction in Institutional Settings, with Caroline Segsworth, Stephen Vinci, and Chris Brown. A little bit on each of our presenters today. Caroline is a building science specialist with over 15 years of experience in the building design and construction industry. She has worked in the fields of architecture and building envelope consulting throughout the Pacific Northwest, Western Canada, and the Western United States. And then on for Chris, with 20 years of architectural experience, Chris has extensive knowledge in all phases of planning and design process through construction administration. He's previously presented on sustainable schools and seismic resiliency for AIA Oregon, CxA+BE, and the Living Future Conference, and has contributed for publications on high-performance buildings for education. And then we have Stevan, who is a building science and sustainability specialist who focuses in passive design, material resiliency, and energy efficiency, which help create sustainable and durable buildings that give more than they take. He serves as the Building Envelope Commissioning Practice Lead for Morrison Hershfield and has provided building science expertise on high-performance building projects in the U.S., Canada, South America, Europe, and China. So without stealing any more precious time, we're going to hand it off to our experts today to kick things off.
Sorry, can everybody hear me? I was having a little difficulty.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Well, thanks everybody for joining us. My name is Stephen Vinci. We'll go through some of these slides. Hopefully, this first one is just the course description, which everybody has, I'm sure, as well as the learning objectives. We'll try to get through the session today. Starting it off, I'm just going to touch on some of the, you know, the strategies that you would do from a new construction to existing buildings. From a low energy standpoint, you know, new construction, it's a pretty lineal thought process, right? You start with, it's a blank page, you start with the massing and form, you start looking at the building envelope, some easy passive strategies, start looking into the mechanical, you know, active systems, and then onto controls to sort of get down to your low energy budget net zero building. When it comes to existing buildings, you know, a lot of that stuff just gets thrown out the window because, you know, there's not a clear place to start. But basically, you need to know the scope of the building. Like, what's the scope of the project? Are you just touching the envelope? Are you looking at mechanical systems? What is it? So it's a very non-linear process. And you're looking at it from the aspect that basically, any existing building has the potential of becoming net zero, but perhaps the scope or the budget could hinder a lot of that stuff. You know, and you always want to take into consideration, what are you doing new to that building? You know, could, if you're just looking at the envelope, are you making it too airtight for the existing HVAC system to adequately ventilate it? As well as with existing buildings, there's always that fine balance that, you know, is energy always the end goal? Lately, the trend is becoming to focus more on carbon, especially embodied carbon. So there's always that, you know, existing materials versus assemblies to, you know, replacing, you know, adding new stuff. Where's that fine balance between low energy and low carbon? But before we can act, we have to have a plan related to existing buildings. So, you know, coming up with a project plan, you know, the RFP kind of gives some information, but, you know, should predate the plan. The more important thing is to get into, you know, a very good, clear, and concise owner's project requirement that will outline all the performance goals, as well as looking at the scope of the project. And so your action depends on that scope. You know, a lot of these items may make its way into the OPR, but it's sort of, again, you know, what's included in the scope, what level of energy performance are you trying to achieve, and sort of what level of modeling and testing would be done. And a lot of that comes into, you know, when you're identifying the scope, it's your project type, you know, project team, who's the owner hiring for the team, like what resources do you have, what specialists are on there. You know, each project type and each geographic location is different. So your approach should match the project type and location, as well as the schedule. And of course, the all important thing, the budget. One thing to not lose track of though, when you're looking at low energy buildings, is sort of the aspect of building durability. So people tend to think of, you know, a durable building as something, you know, brick, stone, something, you know, very rugged. But in the essence, it's the ability of the building or any of its components to perform its required function in a service, in its service environment, so its location, over a period of time without any unforeseen cost for maintenance and repair. Getting into the OPR, there's some guiding rules. You'll start with some overall goals, you know, overarching sustainability, energy, aesthetics, you know, as well as the budget. And then you'll get into specific items, sort of preferred materials, maybe testing, what sort of benchmarking will we be doing, as well as some QAQC process through design and construction. Some of the keys to success of using an owner's project requirement is sort of, you know, outline your performance goals. It's basically that record of what is very important to the owner or to the client. It should be used and have input by all project team stakeholders. You don't want somebody making it, you know, that's not mechanical engineer or mechanically inclined making decisions on mechanical performance, things like that. And one thing that we see a lot of projects that don't have very good success is that they take the OPR as sort of a formality, sort of that, yep, we did it here, check that off for the lead submission and we're done. One and done. It should not be taken as that. You should be using this and updating it throughout the projects at all phases. So with that, I'll hand it over to Chris. We'll go through two projects.
Hey, everybody. My name is Chris Brown, and I work at Mahlum Architects. I'm part of our Portland office. We also have an office in Seattle, and we focus primarily on schools and healthcare. Today, I'll be talking about two of Mahlum's projects, Lake Ridge, which is a new middle school building, and Grant, which is the modernization of an existing high school. First off, with Lake Ridge, as the Lake Ridge school bond was being written for voter approval, community advocates encouraged the school directly to create a building that will be exceptionally energy efficient. One great success of this project was qualifying for approximately $300,000 in utility funded incentives through the Energy Trust of Oregon's Path to Net Zero Energy Ready program. Using bundled design strategies that were more cost-effective than traditional systems. Supported by the Energy Trust's early design assistance, our shoebox modeling with PAE engineers revealed a path toward net zero energy, relying on the compounding reductions of several strategies. These included optimized daylighting and efficient lighting, a robust building envelope, and highly efficient active and passive mechanical systems. These measures bring us under the target energy use index of 22. With this minimized energy use, there's sufficient area on the roof of the building for PV panels to be added at a later date to achieve net zero energy. Window sizes and locations are optimized to harness natural daylight throughout the school. Vacancy sensors allow users to turn on electric lights when they're needed rather than automatically turning on when someone enters the room. And daylight sensors adapt dimming to balance light levels in each space. Classrooms are oriented with windows facing north and south for better control of daylight. Exterior sunshades reduce glare and solar heat gain at all south-facing classrooms and the west-facing music wing as well. This further reduces the reliance on mechanical cooling. So to achieve the community and district goal for a net zero energy ready school while constrained by a tight budget, our team with PAE engineers and RLB cost estimators evaluated two design options to compare pricing against a traditional baseline model. The baseline mechanical costs for a variable air volume system with full heating and air conditioning was about $4.6 million. We then compared it to a ground source heat pump system with a slinky style piping. And while that could achieve the net zero energy ready goal with envelope improvements, this option would have added $1.3 million in mechanical equipment costs above the baseline VAV estimate. Second option, we looked at, we compared hybrid passive cooling, which eliminates much of the expensive VAV equipment while relying on a robust envelope and engaged occupants to maintain comfort. What attracted the team to this last option was an estimated $1.2 million in HVAC savings that would be offset partially by approximately $800,000 of envelope upgrades and other system improvements. And that resulted in a bundled savings of $400,000. This was the key to meeting the net zero energy goal on a tight budget. We call the system a hybrid passive cooling for two reasons. First, it's only used where activities are conductive and occupants can manage their comfort most readily, such as the learning studios and the commons, the classroom areas and commons or cafeteria. The other spaces, including the gyms, library, administration, and music classrooms, have traditional VAV equipment with full air conditioning. The second reason for calling this a hybrid approach is that the dedicated outside air system or DOAS units include a small coil to provide modest heating and cooling to temper the incoming outdoor ventilation air by about plus or minus 5 to 10 degrees Fahrenheit. Throughout the year, the DOAS ventilation and internal heat gain are enough to keep occupants comfortable within the robust envelope. When outside temperatures reach freezing, electric cove heaters are used to maintain comfort. In Lake Oswego, some of our hottest days of the summer can be 100 degrees or more in the afternoon, but maybe as cool as 60 or 65 degrees early the next morning. Using this diurnal swing, the DOAS ventilation system provides automated night flushing to wash cold air over the exposed concrete floors. But passive cooling also relies on student and faculty engagement to operate. When outside conditions become conductive to passive cooling, the light on the control panel in each classroom will turn from red to green. This indicates it's time to open the windows. Next, a student pushes the center button, which will open the air damper in the roof shaft, allowing air to flow up and out of the building. Once the roof air damper is open, the center button will turn green to indicate the passive cooling is active. Although the ambient air temperatures within the classroom may reach 75 degrees at peak summer afternoons, the cool concrete floors and ceiling fans provide comfort to the occupants with passive radiation and gentle air movement. In addition to optimized HVAC costs, our design team found other ways to support the district's budget and project goals. Even after the significant 70% energy use reduction, the remaining 22 predicted EUI would require a very large 900 kW solar array to offset the energy use achieve net zero energy. Here's a diagram showing where the planned PV can be located. In Oregon, there's a requirement on projects that receive state funding to spend 1.5% of the project budget on green energy technology. Typically, projects purchase solar panels with this portion of the budget, but this graph shows that the typical application for solar panels would only offset 1/3 of the school's demand to reach net zero energy. So rather than only buying a portion of the needed PV, the project team applied the 1.5% green energy technology budget to invest in envelope upgrades. The combined benefits from passive systems and lighting controls amount to 32% reduced energy use, exclusive of plug loads. This exceeded the 20% passive savings required to use this for the green energy technology compliance. Rather than renewable energy systems that need to be replaced every 20 to 30 years, these passive features will remain in service, reducing energy demand and providing comfort for the life of the building. Building from our preliminary energy model as the project developed, we evaluated the costs and benefits of various building envelope components. By upgrading to triple pane fiberglass windows, we could lower the assembly R value of the walls from R40 down to R30, with additional bundled cost savings. Later, we optimized the roof insulation to R50 and underslab insulation to R5 to maintain occupant comfort. So there was definitely a kind of a back and forth between the project budget and things that we had to study as we went along to maximize the value that we were providing in terms of the energy benefit. Lakeridge Middle School has another path to be net zero energy ready because it's designed with all electric systems and no natural gas connection to the building. As our regional energy utility grid becomes fully renewable over the next couple of decades, this facility will leverage its great energy use reductions without burning fossil fuels on site. Finally, Lakeridge is a wood frame building, and we even went so far as to use parts of trees that had been cut down as building structure. One big driver for the use of wood was our striving to minimize the embodied carbon of the materials we use. This is a good transition to the next project because reuse of material and minimizing embodied carbon both played an important role in that project. So now I'll talk a bit about Grant High School. And in a few minutes, I'll discuss the overall goals of the project and how these are brought forth in the design. But first, I wanted to talk a little bit about embodied carbon, which is the energy that's needed to extract, transport, manufacture, install, and demolish materials. I'll start with this chart that comes from Architecture 2030. Now, keeping in mind that we're trying to reach net zero energy as soon as possible to prevent as much global warming as we can, this chart looks out over a 20-year timeframe for new construction projects. And it shows that if we go at the rate we're going, we're actually using more carbon embodied in materials than the operational carbon used to heat, cool, and power these buildings. And that's what you see, the 50%, 57% embodied carbon is in the construction of the new buildings. And then, of course, the operational carbon it grows as time goes on and there are more new buildings over that period. So in other words, I guess materials are a huge contributor when it comes to carbon. And this is the part of the reason that I think they say the greenest building is the one that already exists. So we can do a whole building life cycle analysis to compare renovation, new construction. This is an example from a project where we used Tally software to compare the two. You can see the orange existing building and blue new building in this example. And then you can see the breakdown by product category on the left with the as-built and hypothetical new buildings. So of course the renovation, as you would expect, used a lot less embodied carbon, particularly when it comes to the structure and the envelope. And we use Tally software on this. It's a Revit plugin and it works really well. I think it's really important for architects to understand how the choices they make affect embodied carbon use. But to be honest, while these numbers are kind of intellectually interesting, they weren't that useful in the decision-making process beyond knowing the big picture. There were other important considerations, such as the importance to the community of the existing building that really drove which buildings were reused. I think the real strength in doing embodied carbon analysis is comparing one building system to another as you make choices. And that could be either for new or existing building designs. And that said, for Grant, I did do a quick estimate of the total embodied carbon in the reused existing buildings. And here are some of the equivalencies. I got about 4.5 million kilograms of CO2. So what this represents is the energy it would use to replace the structure and envelope that was reused in the building. It's kind of hard to get your head around what this quantity means, but it definitely seems like a lot. And in comparing to some other types of energy use. You can see that it is a lot. For example, it's equivalent to burning about 5 million pounds of coal. So coming back to determining what the overall design goals were, as with Lake Ridge, the project started out gathering input from the community on what their priorities were. This was not a trivial endeavor. We held over 15 meetings with the school's design advisory group and over 200 meetings with various groups of community and stakeholders throughout the design process. There were a number of priorities that were identified, but one that had a huge impact on the project was the value that the community placed in the historic buildings. Here's what the campus looked like in 1927 with open connection to the park from the building, which consisted of classrooms on each side of long corridors. This is known as kind of the cells and bells approach to traditional school layouts. And here we can see the campus layout in 2017. The courtyards had been filled in with additions of various shapes and sizes over the years. And I think it's impressive that while people certainly recognized what poor shape the school was in and wanted to fix the extent of the deferred maintenance that was needed, they were still able to see the value of reuse of much of the school. So the existing campus plan left us with a challenging site layout. And the challenges included a lack of connection to the outdoors from the school, maze of unsupervisable circulation paths, lack of space for student gathering or social interaction, and little sense of place on the campus. So what was our approach to all this? You can see here the new addition in orange, including a new gym with two gym floors, as well as a three-story bar that was added along the west side of the existing building. So what this did was to put a lot of square feet vertically we dug out these courtyards to allow more daylight into the basement spaces that were adjacent to the courtyards and then into the lower level of the new addition. And we're able to get three stories of classrooms and new spaces where it didn't get any taller than the existing building. So ultimately, the new site plan is very similar to the shape of the school prior to the numerous additions that were put on. So here we can see a photo of one of the courtyards. This is the auditorium piece here. And digging out the courtyards, this had been the former cafeteria, which was buried underground. And so it's no longer the cafeteria. The cafeteria is on two levels here, opening out into social spaces for the students and gathering spaces outside. On the south side of the auditorium, there's another courtyard that's more of an active courtyard outside the gym spaces. And another way that we used the new addition to modify and improve the existing was to provide connection to nature, to the park that surrounds the building, both in terms of allowing views out of the building to the nice trees and everything in the park, but also, you know, direct physical connections. This is from the second story, a bridge that goes over that courtyard that we were just looking at. Then inside the building, by adding this addition along the west edge, the classrooms that had been on the west edge previously became inside spaces. So we now have classrooms on both sides of the building and then lots of spaces in the center corridor that we used daylighting from above to illuminate. And these spaces are used for social interaction. This is a forum space. We have two forums in the school where we cut a hole in the floor and then have seating looking at a screen. So this space can be used formal teaching. It can be used for informal interaction. Kids can go in there and have lunch. So provides a function that really wasn't there before. And then we also renovated the existing old gym, as it was called. It was built in the 1920s. And it was kind of a classic old space that had a raised track around it. But it was, too small to be a competition gym. And there really weren't any uses that fit well in that space, unfortunately. We had hoped to try to, restore the space. But instead, what we did was put the arts classroom and into the building and made it into an arts complex, punching new windows out so that you can get good daylight into each of the classrooms in that space. And we also restored or replaced the skylight that was over the atrium in the gym. So of course, if you're restoring an old building, there's bound to be lots of issues. The one you see here is with the existing brick on parts of the building. They had used a relatively soft brick when they originally built the building, they used lime mortar between the bricks. However, at some point they came back and repointed with concrete mortar. The concrete doesn't have the ability to expand and contract as much. So basically what that does when moisture gets into the wall, the faces of the brick just start popping off. So it becomes really unsightly. They tried to do some patching on this. So that was one issue that we really needed to deal with on the facade. You can also see an old window here. This is one of the remaining wood windows. Most of the windows have been replaced in the 80s with aluminum windows that actually had panels that blocked much of the daylight for whatever reason. They thought that was a good idea. So in order to get the brick didn't, is a different size than the current brick is and different color. So we decided that we'd like to try and reuse the brick off of the west side of the building where we were tearing the brick facade off. So rather than going through and doing that brick by brick, they just knocked down the face of the building and went through and collected whatever brick wasn't broken. I think we had enough brick that we were able to use that technique, and that was a bit less expensive than trying to go through and individually take the bricks off one by one. And of course, replacing the brick on the facade, going through and looking and determining each brick that needed to be replaced and then pulling those out, quite an endeavor. And somehow this brick, triple wife brick wall, you can see it's the brick still stays up with the mortar. This was kind of what parts of the building looked like before we came back in and replaced the brick. And then the final product here with the new facade, not really a close-up of the brick, but it's all been restored. And then the new windows, which are aluminum. They're hung replica windows. So you can see here that some of them are open with the awning style window that looks like a double hung window. So you get a much tighter weather seal on those. But still respect the history that we were trying to restore the building to. Another big material conversation during design was the floor finishes. There was a debate between reusing the existing concrete floors and polishing those with a densifier product versus putting in new vinyl tile. Of course, the vinyl has material health considerations, not necessarily for the occupants of the building, but in the manufacture of vinyl. That was important to us. I think more important to the owner was the life cycle costs of these. So we did a life cycle cost analysis comparing restoring the concrete floors, which you can see there are lots of areas where we had to come in and patch. and other areas where the concrete was degraded, and you know, a lot of work to do on that. So it was not the cheapest option to use exposed concrete floors. However, when we did the life cycle analysis, the vinyl tile requires a lot more maintenance, upkeep. And so when you consider those factors, the district decided to go with the lesser life cycle cost of restoring the concrete floors. So you can see, it's a little hard to see in these, but you know, our designer referred to the concrete floors as being lively, and you know, different amounts of aggregate exposed in different places, and then patches all over the place. But I do think, you know, and here's an existing original column that you can see in there as well. We kind of embrace that aesthetic of thinking about that as character rather than as defects. And then finally, I'll talk a little bit about the new gym reuse. So this is what was referred to as the new gym. This is the old gym that was turned into the arts complex. So this was built in the 60s. You can see it really was not sensitive to the campus layout or anything like that. So when we tore that building down, we kept the walls of the basement and took out the floor of the basement to turn it into what's called an infiltration gallery. We filled that with gravel and piped all of the stormwater from across the site into this pool, and then covered it back up again. So you can see the finished product. Nobody's really even aware that it's there, but it's a valuable, sustainable tool to filter the water while reusing the structure of the old building. Also in that old building, there was a fair amount of wood that we reused. There's Doug fir on the bleachers and a maple floor. So that was something, while it didn't pencil out necessarily to restore the wood, because it was quite a process to pull out each piece individually and then refinish it. You know, this was something that the owner felt was important as far as both the embodied carbon in the wood, as well as just the character, the durability of the wood finishes. It actually was a plus here. I think some people think of wood as, you know, something that needs a lot of maintenance, but in general, we found that schools like it. It's durable and repairable if it does get scratched up or vandalized. So you can see that was the maple in the previous one. And then here we have the Doug fir on some of these surfaces as well. This is the main stair that we put in, connecting the three levels in front of the auditorium. And finally, I think there was an element of nostalgia, I guess you might call it, in terms of reusing parts of the building. Here from the gym, we took individual pieces and cut the pieces of floor out and then installed them in the new building. And so with respect to the reuse of wood as finishes, I think the cost was likely equal to or greater than replacing it with new, but there's both embodied carbon value and then the nostalgia factor that are hard to put numbers onto what exactly that value is. But I think the feedback we've gotten on the wood and the project in general has just been really positive. So with that, I will hand it over to Caroline.
Thanks very much, Chris. So, it was really nice to see the tour of kind of the big ideas behind the designs and be able to get a sense of, you know, what the overarching ideas were behind the project. And I'm going to take a little bit of time now to walk us through how we implemented those designs from initial discussions through to the actual construction and occupation of each building. as noted, the focus will be primarily on the enclosure. So there won't be too much on the mechanical electrical side here, but we do interact with those consultants pretty regularly. So jumping back to Lake Ridge, as Chris mentioned, there were a lot of unique conditions on the building that allowed us to take advantage of passive design conditions and passive elements, and also the use of a lot of wood, which combined to make some pretty intricate details. And so early on in the design phase, we want to make sure we have as many voices at the table as we can so that we can weed through the details, look at how the different components come together, and make sure that we're all, you know, in the same frame of mind about how we're going to achieve those goals. During that design process, we're looking really into the details, towards the design development end and into construction documents to look at how construction sequencing actually affects the implementation and how it may or may not support your energy efficiency goals. And so in this detail on the one side, you can see we've got a number of different components coming together. So we've got a car deck and canopy, we've got a shear wall of laminated plywood, we've got a CLT roof deck, and a majorly thick wood curb and thick insulated roof above that. And so in order to maintain an air separation through all these different elements, we have a series of different membrane components that need to come together to do that. And as much as we wanted to make that clear on paper, it really boiled down to being able to do it in a standalone mock-up. And so we move from those design considerations into building a mock-up. And one of the best tools that you can have on a new construction project is a standalone mock-up that allows all of the different details, especially of the enclosure, to come together, both for aesthetic, you know, sort of observation and confirmation, but largely for performance and detail verification. So here you can see all of the different transitions that would be considered and sort of mocked up in that way, the different detailing and by the different trades, the different elements, and that further gets us into testing down the way so we can use this as a tool going forward. And then when we're in the design, obviously a lot of things can go wrong, and you know, we have this perfect plan that we're starting out with, and you show up to site and maybe one of the trades is used to using a certain material and it may not be in the spec, like you see here with these basket fasteners through our weather barrier, which is also acting as our air barrier. We ended up with a lot of missed fasteners, a lot of backed out fasteners, and these are kinds of things that get hidden pretty quickly on a project. So if you're not paying attention to them and if you're not looking at them, they can have a real impact on how well your building performs and even potentially the long-term durability of it. In this condition, you can see we've left a small gap behind our girts to allow for drainage behind that, which improves the sort of performance of the wall in a watershedding capacity, but also allows for some venting. Effectively, the team had to come together and decide whether or not to continue with this, and ended up with a system that would mitigate that risk, which was a sealant-based pin. Similarly, where we had a lot of interaction with the mechanical and electrical sort of components were at the doghouses for the passive ventilation system, where we have a double door louver that's exposed to a lot of wind-driven rain. As you can see from most of these photos of the project, there's a lot of water in Lake Oswego to contend with. And so when we showed up to site and found that the mechanical systems, the actuators had been placed at the sill of these components, you know, that was something that had not come up in the design, was how we would interact with those different systems. And so modifications were required and had to be tracked throughout the project and sort of identified to make sure that we were keeping both goals in mind for water tightness and energy performance and the long-term durability again of the building. And so in looking at any construction project, new construction or retrofit at all, there's going to be risks to the enclosure that can sort of undermine those targets. So you wanna make sure you're paying attention to sequencing, scope gaps, you know, what the weather is, what the compatibility issues are of materials you're placing, when they can be placed. If something goes wrong with a major system, say you place a roof in a frosty day and you end up entraining a lot of water in that assembly, it can throw a lot of the benefits gained from whatever you might have chosen for it out the door because you may need to reinstall it. So you've effectively doubled your material purchase, you've doubled your labor time, you've doubled your install time, and you sacrifice a lot of your good design because of a thoughtless approach during construction. So it's really, really important to have collective conversations at the beginning of construction, a pre-construction meeting where everybody understands what is necessary for those different components and how they interact with all of the adjacent assemblies. So I'll just take you through a couple slides looking at some of these issues here where you can see the best laid plans, you know, to keep our roof deck dry during construction and our canopies dry wasn't entirely successful. We did show up to site and find that water that had been entrained in the wood here evaporating out and condensing on the underside of this poly sheet, and in other cases just leaking into that poly sheet. So making sure that the team is able to dry that out before it gets encapsulated is really key. On the bottom left here, you can see a night seal. So this is the way that the roofing team with their nice burly roof assembly is able to protect those components that they've installed at the end of each working day and ensure that there's not an event that can otherwise impact the performance down the line. And like I said, there's always going to be these little things that come up following design, you know, whether it's an installation issue like this fish mouth at a seam in the weather barrier or missing membrane at the sill to jam. These kinds of issues are maybe small on their own, but become much larger when you look at them holistically and you end up seeing, you know, typically we see 200 or 300 little things like this throughout the course of a project. And it's really important to make sure that they're documented and tracked so that both the issue itself and the repaired condition get tracked and rolled into project documentation. Oftentimes what we'll find on things like this canopy support beam installed after the fact, we have an intersection now with the glazing system, with our cladding girts, with our weather barrier and other structural elements that detailing while in the field is a lot more difficult than it would have been if we had sort of had the opportunity to look at that component before. So always making sure that you can vet those designs as early as possible is really key. And so then we move into our verification phases. And like I said, we would typically start that with the standalone mock-up or an in-situ mock-up. The images here show both air leakage testing and water testing of our window systems. These are the triple pane fiberglass windows that Chris was discussing. And this gives us an opportunity to make sure that we have, you know, the right materials and that the manufacturing has been consistent with the data sheets and what our expectations are. And then we'll move into field testing from here. And so what we want to try and have each project team consider is that we would like to test at a mock-up. So you test the initial installation, then you test again in the field during maybe 10%, 50%, and 70% complete so that you're consistently monitoring the product that arrives on site and the installation of it. And these tests, especially for the windows, will give you information about how both your wall and your window and the intersection between those two elements are performing. And that will carry on throughout all of the different systems throughout the enclosure. So we do a lot of wand testing for skylights. We do things like sealant testing, you know, where you're looking at maybe doing a pull test for every 1,000 linear feet. That is at each different kind of enclosure joint where you have a weather seal that you're looking to test. And we'll look at a couple other testing elements on the grant project as well. So as Chris mentioned, with the grant high school, we had a lot of existing infrastructure that we were planning to work with. And we had the opportunity as a design team to come together early and observe the enclosure. And as early as you can get the team on board to review existing documents and history of repair, anything that may impact your ability to detail your project to meet the goals you have the better. So we want to have all of those voices at the same time, where we're looking at the different components that we have on site, whether or not they're available to be reused, whether or not we need to look at replacement, you know, is our wood in sound condition? Do we have sound lintels? Are storefront glazing assemblies still desirable? Here you've got an image of the old gym with the raised track that Chris was mentioning here that became the art studio. And we'll get into more detail on these as well, where we start to take apart components and observe how they're actually put together. The difficulty is that it can be very challenging to take some of these elements apart and put them back in a weather-tight condition on historic properties, because there's usually so many unusual things that are happening. So like at this parapet corner cap here, you've got a terracotta cap over the triple wide brick and painted aluminum flashing over top of that. And all of these elements are effectively open to the weather, and anything that we pulled apart could have a potential impact to the enclosed space below. So you have to be very careful and mindful in your assessment as well. But clearly there was a reason why we needed to come in and do some repairs to the project. And so you take that information that you've gained during your assessment phases, and maybe you've prioritized the repairs and you've identified key elements that can support your energy targets for the adaptive reuse. And now you're looking at, again, fleshing out that design so that it highlights the intersection between those existing components and the new components, and that you're balancing what you're placing within the new wall or within the existing wall with new elements, how those perform. So where you have new windows, per se, going into an existing wall, is it meaningful to have a high performing glazing system when you have a low performing wall, and what are the trade-offs there? And in this case, a lot of it came down to being able to restore the historic character of the project while providing something that would shed water and protect the wall as much as possible when it was repaired. And so you can see how, like in this these sections, you can see the amount of original structure and the sort of quantity of new components that were added in. So where it's grayed out, you've got the existing building, and where it's black, obviously that's the new component. Second here. So digging in a little bit more, here we have on the left the original condition for the parapet. And when we wanted to come in and really improve the performance of the roof assembly and gain ourselves, you know, that much more of a thermal break, that much better weather protection, we take apart those components, but it becomes really difficult to know that we aren't undermining the performance of the roof by sealing to the triple wide brick that is not itself sealed. So by taking our roofing assembly up these walls, are we exposing it to wind-driven rain or wicking from the backside where these bricks remain exposed? And so we ended up using a combination of fluid-applied membranes, brick removal, and a lot of different components. So you can see on the backside of that assembly, it looks a little bit hodgepodge, but on the exterior, you know, viewed from the street, it actually looks pretty identical to the original condition, but a little tidier. Similarly, we have these components where we're tying in a new roof assembly to an entirely existing wall. And in sort of taking our roofing up that to match, you know, industry standards for clearance. Excuse my dog. So we've got water shedding that may happen behind this layer of brick that would infiltrate behind the roofing again. And so we needed to remove bands of brick from across the wall to allow us to tie our roofing into the primary structure of these assemblies, which was thankfully a cast in place concrete wall with damp proofing on it, to give us this final clean solution where we have protected our new assembly and improved the performance of our existing. In another condition where we were implementing seismic upgrades, we also encountered gaps along the wall where those arms were buttressing back to the existing brick wall. Thankfully, we were using a fluid applied product, so we had a hot mopped vapor barrier on our roof deck here, and it allowed us to vary our substrate a little bit more readily than you might have done with a sheet good. But there was a lot of mutual conversations about how we would achieve this, both with structural, architectural, and the enclosure, to make sure that we weren't creating a problem in either direction. Similarly, where we were excavating within existing structures that were not used for classrooms, in this case, we were taking the boiler room and creating a childcare and office area, where we didn't have the capacity to remove existing soil and existing structure at the exterior, we were forced to make design decisions that would maybe not fly in new construction, where instead of having an excavated wall with fully positive applied waterproofing, we now have this sort of interstitial wall that is a bit of a guard on the interior of the project. And so it's allowed to weep to the exterior through manually installed holes. Just a couple of images here to show how much tidier the new roof and the different penetrations and different elements we had are. Unfortunately, there's a little bit of ash on the roof there from some fires that year. But sort of taking a step back again and thinking about how we initiate our construction. On this project, because we have both the retrofit condition and the new conditions, we have a standalone mock-up for the new conditions, but we had this in-situ mock-up we needed to do for our windows in the retrofit areas. And in doing so, we uncover, you know, we have a very irregular substrate to work with. We have a lot of paths for migration behind our brick that we wouldn't typically encounter. And it involved a lot of building up of different components around that and trying to tie into the face of the brick in such a way that would shed water and maintain performance and still look moderately like it was original and intended. You see the different components here versus the standalone mock-up for the new elements, which are, you know, very much more what we're familiar with. We've got steel lintels and sealed sheathing boards and everything like that that we're planning and vetting together. So looking at this architecturally as well as from an envelope perspective. And then moving into testing for these guys. So for the windows in the retrofit area, we ended up having to take our original construction detail, and I'll save you the 30-page document that this came from, but it basically had to be broken down into a component by component, step-by-step installation phase so that we could ensure that each element of the existing wall was verified and appropriately sealed and appropriately supported. And then that we have the intended finish without compromising any of the assemblies above, below, or around it. And in doing our testing, we were forced to sort of block off areas of the existing walls to make sure that we weren't testing the existing assembly, because there was some risk that we might actually draw water through the original structure into our chamber at the interior. On the standalone mock-up for the new builds, it was more sort of standard procedure here, where we're doing our air and water testing. I think it's interesting in this one where you can see the weep holes in the brick assembly really doing their job, with water being sprayed to the lintel above and allowing it out of the system at grade. We also had a few areas with below grade waterproofing. And so here we were doing, you know, an initial mock-up in situ where we were just placing it on the existing or on the new substrate and doing some adhesion testing, millage testing during installation, and also making sure that we're vetting that product as it goes on the wall. So you can see some blisters that occurred and needed to be repaired, and that was a result of improper substrate preparation. So there's, you know, every component that goes into the enclosure is really going to affect the long-term performance. And it comes down to such finite or such minute, sorry, detailing to make sure that you actually hit those targets in the field. Other testing that is completed, a lot of the time, especially to make sure that you're hitting your air leakage rates, would be whole building air leakage testing, which was completed at Grant. and was done in sort of a compartmentalized way. I think a lot of us were skeptical about testing the original building, but we managed to pass and everybody was feeling pretty good about that. And so you have a lot of opportunity to demonstrate that your design has been successfully implemented in the field. And I think with that, I will let my colleagues make any closing remarks they have, and otherwise we can take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Caroline.
I'll go first. This is Steve. I would say, you know, one thing to take away from this, from especially the existing building, and even new construction for that matter as well, is sort of, you know, get yourself out of that machine thinking. Right? Every time, you know, people may have a standardized approach, maybe for, you know, project delivery efficiencies and things like that. But sometimes those types of thought processes doesn't provide, you know, there's a lack of flexibility. It's not very adaptive. So I would just say, you know, try to force yourself to take a step back and look at the big picture. You know, there's a lot of new technologies, new ways of doing things when you come up for it. So I would just say, you know, be open to it, explore it, but for sure, test it.
Yeah, and I guess just for my own conclusions, it's obviously there's more flexibility on new construction projects. But that said, you really need to understand, you know, what the constraints are, including the cost limitations, and then find ways to work through those costs. And often that involves, you know, more work of studying different options for the building and doing analysis to quantify what's the cost versus what's the value. But in the long run, you can work through some of those cost barriers. And then for existing buildings, I think the constraints become more numerous, but they also provide opportunities for creative approaches to problem solving. So like Steve was saying, I find it fun to have a new challenge from an existing building.
Agreed. I think the biggest thing, like both of you sort of alluded to, is having everybody come to a consensus on everything. Sam, were you going to feed questions as they come, or should we just open it up?
Yes, let's absolutely get into the Q&A. And if anyone else has any more questions that they'd like to send, just let me know. You haven't gone through any of them, right, Caroline?
No, I think I saw the first one that was about the energy intensity use. Let's see here.
Okay, great. do you have actual or estimated annual kilowatt usage per square feet for the new construction school?
Yeah, so we estimated the EOI, and it was around 21 for that school. But I don't believe that we have any actual use data yet. The school opened partially last year, and then it's, I think, been open fully since this fall. So hopefully soon we'll be getting more numbers on what's actually going on out there.
And another question, do you have published data available to download the case studies?
That's another good question.
Sorry, go ahead.
We did a lot. We collected a lot of data, and I'm not sure exactly what type of data you're referring to. But we submitted this project and won an award for grant for the AIA Committee on Architecture for Education Awards. And I know that they have published. I know we submitted a ton of data using the AIA COAT Top 10 framework for various types of metrics that we were using. I don't know that they actually published those on the AIA website, so I can provide those to you by email if somebody wants to contact me. I'm just cbrown at mahlum.com. But happy to share whatever data you're looking for.
Okay, and final question. Does the gym have wood flooring? Were there any humidity or dehumidification concerns that you had?
So yes, the new gym that we constructed has wood flooring in both both courts. And then we also put reused, refinished wood as flooring in the old gym, the arts complex. And I think we managed to avoid, you know, the wood floors are raised, so they're ventilated between the slab and the wood. So that takes care of some of the issues. And then I don't believe the wood was installed until the building was closed. So it didn't become a humidity issue on this project.
And maybe just like from a construction standpoint, that does tie back a lot to during construction, maintaining protection for areas that need to be dry and making sure everything is dry before you close it in. So avoiding, you know, placing a lot of vapor retarding products in your enclosure before it's actually protected from rain is a big one for the long term look.
Yeah, especially for the wood construction projects.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, well, I think that's all the questions that we have for today. Stephen, Carol, and Chris, thank you so much for coming on here and sharing your story.
Thank you.
Thank you for having
us. Yeah, thank you guys.
Awesome. All right. Well, this is the second to last webinar in the series. We still have one coming up in December, the 16th, on fire and life safety systems commissioning essentials. So if you're registered, that should be on your calendar and you should have gotten an invite. We are also letting people know to save the date for CX Energy 2022. The technical schedule will be released soon, but if you are someone that's interested in exhibiting or sponsoring, now is the time. So please reach out to us, info@commissioning.org, to secure your spot. They are being sold out, but they should be sold out pretty soon. So those are going, please stay ahead of that. And other than that, everyone enjoy the rest of their day, and we will see you next month. Bye all.